Good morning. It's good to see everyone here this morning. Just before we get started, we're going to go through just a couple of announcements that are in the bulletin. Camp permission slips are in the lobby. If you haven't filled out one of those, please get one and take it home and get it filled out and get it back to Brian. The other thing is that we're going to recognize our graduating seniors next Sunday. So if you have a high school or college graduating senior or someone graduating from any sort of college, please just get with me or Brian or Michaeleen, and we will recognize them next Sunday.
And we don't know when they're going to be back up. The phones are down, so they'll have to contact us through cell phone.
Okay, so the phones are still down.
Maybe tomorrow.
I'm sorry.
Maybe tomorrow.
Okay. So the phones might be up tomorrow, but if not, please just get a hold of us on our cell phones and that will work. Are there any other announcements?
Do we know about Richie Collins' services?
Viewing for Richie is tonight from 6 to 8 at Latimer.
Okay, viewing for Richie Collins is tonight from 6 to 8 at Latimer.
And then services tomorrow at 2.
Services are tomorrow at 2.
If you bring a meal or a dish for the meal, please bring it by 11.
Okay. Please have any dishes for the meals by 11 tomorrow. All right. With that, if you will please stand with me. Read our scripture. Nehemiah 2:20. So I answered to them and said to them,
the God of heaven will give us success. Therefore, we, his servants, will rise and build. But you have no portion, right or memorial in Jerusalem.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning and we just thank you and we praise you. And Father, we are so grateful for this opportunity to meet together and to worship you. Father, we just pray for the families that are hurting right now. Father, we just pray for our community. And Father, we pray for our church families here in town, Father. And we know that there's a lot of pain and hurt, Father. But this morning, we come to you and we praise you, and we know that you are good. Yes. Father, we just pray that we will lift our voices high, and Father, we just do all this in the name of Jesus. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
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 Come, now's the time for worship. Thank you.
whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King of all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King of all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life that I would be saved. Worthy is the Lamb who slain.
Here we, as assembly, we practice communion every week. As a member that's been raised in another church where communion was practiced and served only once a month or twice a year, early on here, I sort of questioned our practice. I wondered if it would become routine or meaningless. You know, and even after 15 years of being in this church, I might welcome you to the wrong building. But our participation in the Lord's Supper reminds me on a weekly basis, there's nothing routine or meaningless about it.
Amen.
But first, it's always good to remember why we observe communion. And it's not because of the feelings that it gives us, but it's because the Creator of the universe told us to do it. Whether or not I'm thinking profound religious thoughts at the time or the moment that I take the cup, I'm still doing it to remember Him.
Yes.
And that's reassuring to me because there's always those odd moments when you're distracted. When you're distracted at the moment that you take the cup or when you pass the tray or for the men serving, there's a distraction. But the Bible also says that when we take communion, we're proclaiming the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ.
Yes.
So my act of participation means something. But the original question still yet, does communion lose its meaning if it's done too often? The answer is sort of complicated, but yes, communion can lose its meaning. But it has nothing to do with the quantity of times that we partake. It's about the quality of the preparation of our heart.
Yes.
Preparation for communion starts at different times for different people. It might start on Saturday night. It might start on Sunday morning at breakfast or the devotional. It may even start on your way to church in the car. But don't worry, if you get here and you're still not ready, that's fine. We got you. We've got prayer. We've got music. We've got meditation. Because preparation for communion is multi-moment. And you pick your moment. Since becoming a dad, I understand the importance of saying, I love you. And how deeply meaningful it is to hear my son say it back to me every chance we get. Christ's death on the cross was his way of saying, I love you. Communion is our chance to say, I love you too. And we should do that every chance we get.
Yes. Yes.
Dear Lord, thank you for this moment that we're able to gather here in your name, Lord. As we partake of the prayer that was represents your body that was being approved on the cross for us, Lord, just please let us do so with our hearts intact and do things in a manner pleasing to you, Lord. Would you stand on prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, we just continue our prayer to you, thanking you for all your many, many blessings. So thankful, Father, for your love, your grace, and your mercy. And so thankful, Father, for Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. So thankful, Father, for our radiant King of the Light. So thankful for his glory that is shining all around us. And we just pray, Father, that as we take of this cup, which represents the blood Jesus shed on the cross, to wash away our sins, Father, that we will do so in a manner well-pleasing in thy sight. And we pray these things, Father, in Jesus Christ, the Lord.
Matthew chapter 26 tells us that at the Last Supper, Jesus took the bread. It says, now as they were eating, verse 26, Jesus took bread. After blessing it, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body. And he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. For this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. And the Apostle Paul reminds us, whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. All God's people say it. Amen. Surely there are children in this room who know how the system works. Y'all cheat. You just sit up front every morning. Come on, Toby. Come on, Bash. Now, is this something that you should say over a microphone? What were y'all doing? You were sitting with each other? That's awesome. Are you good friends? Good. Well, you know, part of being in church, it helps to know that you've got good friends and family to be with you, doesn't it? All right. Well, you know, I always want to ask y'all a question. I'm going to ask you a big, deep, I'm not going to use the big word, well, I'll use it, theological question. Theological means thinking about God, deep thoughts about God. I'm going to ask you a big, deep question about God. Why do we pray? Okay, you tell me. You just take your time with it, Tristan. If you're bad, what will he do?
Well, mad.
Well, maybe more sad than mad. But if you tell him what you did, what does he do? But he also forgives us. So, part of prayer is telling God that we're sorry. Okay, that's a big part of it. Absolutely. It says in the Bible, if we confess, he's faithful and just to forgive us. Finn and then Jacob. Prayer is a way to worship God. Absolutely. Have you ever just sat and just prayed and said, I love you, God? Have you ever just walked up to your parents and said, I love you? So if we as earthly parents who aren't perfect love to hear I love you, what could be more worshipful than telling God that you love him? I'm going to tell you a secret. Sometimes when I'm driving long distances, my truck radio doesn't work. And so that's sometimes all I do is just tell God how much I love him. That's a good way to do it. That's a good way to worship. Jacob, what did you want to say, bud? To talk to God and thank him, yeah. Now, here's an amazing thing is, y'all, if I was to ask some of the adults this, they wouldn't give as good a response as you. Because like sometimes I'll tell you, as an adult, I get selfish when I pray. Grown-ups, how many of us sometimes can get selfish when we pray? You can too? Well, hey, I'm glad you can admit it. Because that's a tough thing to admit. Sometimes, many of us have been guilty in our lifetime of just praying when we're desperate. Praying when we really are sad or angry. But just like, you know, I've got four kids on this front pew. They like coming up and saying, I love you. Don't you think the God of the universe likes hearing it from us too? And just saying thank you for another day. Thank you for my mom and dad. Thank you for my grandparents. Thank you for my friends. Thank you for everything. It's a good thing. And talking to God is important. And so I want to encourage y'all. The Bible says to pray without stopping. That doesn't mean you just like say, "Hi, my name is Brian. Thank you, Lord, for everything you're doing." Just not out loud, you know? That would be distracting. But even in your head and in your heart, just being grateful and thankful to God is an amazing thing to do. So I'm really proud of y'all's answers. I really want y'all to continue to pray, okay? Well, that's what the certificate says. I am his dad. Yes, I'm really his dad. Thank you for bringing Tristan. I love you. You're awesome, Tristan. You want honesty? You talk to Tristan. All right, y'all, you go have a great class today, okay? Mind your teachers.
Okay.
Woo. I don't care who you are. If you're sad after listening to these guys every Sunday morning, you got deeper issues and you need to come forward for prayer when the time comes. So this morning I'm going to confess something to you. I had a hard time pinning down what I wanted to talk about. It's because this subject matter is so difficult that I think this side of heaven we really won't understand it completely. This morning during prayer, though, if y'all ever get a chance, you should come join us Sunday morning for prayer time. Brother Allen said something that I know in my heart to be true, but I need to be reminded of. If my God was someone I could understand completely, I wouldn't need to worship him. Think about that. As a matter of fact, the source of our sin is that pride in thinking we are on equal par with this God. The source of that pride states what Satan did in the book of Isaiah. I will make myself like the Most High God. We see it all the time in the opinions we share online or others share. I couldn't imagine my God doing X, Y, or Z. Who's ever heard that before? I'm going to tell y'all something. If that's the way we think, then our God is just simply too small. My God is unsearchable. My God is unfathomable. My God speaks and stars come from his mouth. And here I am, a speck of dust with a start and an expiration date. Who am I to question it? Last week we spoke about Nehemiah's anguish and how did Nehemiah approach his anguish? He fasted and he prayed. And I think sometimes we misunderstand the purpose of fasting and praying. Fasting and praying is not a way for us to get God to listen to us. He hears us no matter what. He hears the uttermost cries of our hearts. As Paul writes, sometimes when our spirit cries out in groanings too deep to understand, the Lord understands. Fasting and praying has nothing to do with God bending his ear towards us. Even when Moses stood before God on behalf of Israel, fasting and praying is always to conform us to the heart of God. So that even should our prayers not go as we expect, we can love God even through the middle of the worst pain that we can face. Here's what I mean. You please stand. I'm going to read a scripture that's not up on the screen. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8. For we do not want you to be unaware, brothers, of the affliction we experienced in Asia. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired of life itself. Do you hear that pain? Indeed, we felt that we received the sentence of death. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. He delivered us from such deadly peril, and he will deliver us. On him we have set our hope that he will deliver us again. You also must help us by prayer so that many will give thanks on our behalf for the blessings granted to us through the prayers of many. And all God's people said. Amen. Now, please don't mistake me. Please be seated. God does hear us. And God does answer. But God is, again, I cannot stress this enough, so beyond our understanding that I've been in places in my life where before I even uttered the words of my necessity, God had provided. When Paul is asking for prayer in 2 Corinthians, he knows his God will deliver him already. But he knows that when God's people come together and conform their hearts in submission through prayer with thanksgiving, God hears and God honors it. Prayer and fasting has nothing to do with results other than our submission to the heart of God. And so we come to Nehemiah. Nehemiah fasted and he wept and he prayed over the situation in Jerusalem. The walls were broken down, the city was burned by fire, the temple was destroyed, and those who remained within Jerusalem were in great distress. In those days, if your city did not have a wall, you were vulnerable. And what were you vulnerable to? Bandits, raiders, other nations. You were vulnerable. And so Nehemiah, the cupbearer of the king, one who was close to the king of Persia, in his great distress, submitted his heart to the will of God. He confessed his sins, his father's sins, and the sins of his people toward God. They neglected the poor. They thought more highly of themselves than they did of the word of God. And when Nehemiah was done fasting and weeping and praying, he was ready to go before the king. And he did just this. Nehemiah chapter 2 tells us, in the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when wine was before him. Now, let's keep in mind, this is a dangerous position. What did a cupbearer do, y'all? Do you know? He drank before the king. Why? Because if the cupbearer died, the king knew not to drink. This was a man who put his life before the king's. He put his life at the mercy of the king's life. He sacrificed his life. But here's the thing. Back in those days, a king wanted to be surrounded by joy and happiness. So if you were to walk in front of the king with a long face, that could mean, at worst, your execution, and at best, your exile. Nehemiah submitted his heart to God. He was ready to face whatever he faced, and he went before the king, even in his trouble. Listen to this. Now I had not been sad in his presence. He means before. The king said to me, why is your faith sad? Seeing as you're not sick. This is nothing but sadness of the heart. Let's pause there for a minute. Nehemiah, as we can see by this, was more than merely a servant. The king trusted Nehemiah with his life. I would dare say the king probably counted Nehemiah, probably unlike very many people in his kingdom, as a close personal friend. If you're dependent upon somebody else, wouldn't you want a friend there? Then I was very much afraid. I said to the king, let the king live forever. This wasn't anything but a custom. They knew he wouldn't. Why should not my face be sad when the city, the place of my father's graves, lies in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire? The king asked. Nehemiah answered. Then the king said to me, what are you requesting? Now listen to this. So I prayed to the God of heaven. What should always follow fasting when we are in the circumstance that we are facing? More prayer. Nehemiah didn't utter it out loud, just as we talked about with the kids, but he prayed. He put his hands, not in the hands of a heathen king, but in the hands of God Almighty. In the same way, if we look all throughout the exile, there are many within this story of the exile of the Jews being kicked out of Jerusalem by God, where we see such a faith. I think of the book of Daniel. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, before King Nebuchadnezzar. There we go. When King Nebuchadnezzar had built this giant statue to himself, that whenever you heard even a chime, you must bow down and pay homage and worship it. Yet three young men from Israel chose not to do so. And the king gave them an opportunity to repent of their sin against him. And what did those three young men say? Our God is fit and capable to deliver us from your punishment. But if not, we will not bow down. The faith of Jerusalem in exile grew because they knew their God kept his promises. They knew their God who delivered their ancestors by making them walk dry land through the Red Sea would deliver them. But if he didn't, they still would trust and have faith in him. So when Nehemiah utters this prayer, he is having the same heart as those three young men, that he knows that his God, one way or the other, will emerge victorious. That you cannot, whether a life is given or taken away, you cannot stop the plans and purposes of God. And Nehemiah is not putting his life in the king's hands. Nehemiah is putting his life in the hands of Almighty God. So he prayed. Verse 5 says, and I said to the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, that you send me to Judah, to the city of my father's graves, that I may rebuild it. And the king said to me, the queen sitting beside him, how long will you be gone, and when will you return? So it pleased the king to send me when I had given him a time. We don't pray to find favor. We pray because the Lord has already given his favor. Nehemiah trusted the hand of his God, and his God honored that trust. We may not always get what we want. As a matter of fact, I always think of two Christian martyrs in the 1500s in England when it was illegal to own a copy of the Bible, because back then the church was political and it wanted to own what people thought. A blind net mender and a lame painter were caught distributing the word of God. And the punishment back then was the same thing given to Tyndale. They were to be burned at the stake. But they weren't afraid of the stake. One looked at the other and said, brother, we're about to be healed. Thee of thy blindness and me of my lameness. That is absolute trust in God. This world has no purchase for us, but God is eternal. God promises eternal life to those who are faithful. And so if you put your hands in Almighty God, whether by living or dying, whether in sickness or health, almost like a wedding vow, you're putting your trust in one who holds all things in his hand. This God has not failed yet. He will not start with you. I'm also reminded at this time of another time of testing. Consider this, after Jesus' baptism, he fasted for 40 days by the Holy Spirit, because it says in the book of Luke that he was led out by the Spirit to the wilderness to fast for 40 days on the power of the Holy Spirit. And I can only imagine what Jesus was doing in the wilderness for that 40 days. But every time I see people fasting in the Bible, they always accompany it with prayer and reminding God of his promises through the scriptures. So for 40 days, Jesus was in the Spirit. No food, just sustaining himself upon the presence of his Holy Father through the Holy Spirit. He was tested. And during that test, Jesus could face the test not because he was strong in his own right, but because at that point in his life, he He depended completely on his Father, as he calls us to do. Jesus is not a do as I say, not as I do preacher. Jesus is a do as I say and watch me do it preacher. And so when Satan came up, hungry as he was, he said, "You can command these stones to turn into bread." But Jesus responded with, "Man shall not live on bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." You see, Jesus fasted and prayed, and by the Spirit that his Father had placed upon him at his baptism, he was able to endure and be sustained. Every word from the mouth of God sustained him. But it doesn't stop there. We're told that the enemy also knows Scripture. You see, when Jesus was being tested, Satan took him to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you're the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you. And on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." Something we need to be cautious of, church, is that the devil knows the Bible just as much, if not better, than we do. It's how there's churches right now filled with people who are led astray by false teachers that they collect for themselves to suit their itching ears, as Paul said they would. Satan knows the Scriptures just enough to twist it to where we are still selfish, even though we claim we're following the holy, unchanging one. Yet how did Jesus answer him? Verse 12. "It is said, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." That is how Jesus responded. With the power of Scripture, through prayer, through the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm reminded of another verse that Paul wrote to the Corinthians. In 1 Corinthians, he said, "God will not allow you to be tested beyond your capability, but he will provide for you a way of escape." And what's that escape? Power through the Holy Spirit, in prayer, and in submission to his word.
Amen.
He's also said that Satan took him on a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world, and said, "All this I will give to you if you bow down and worship me." And Jesus said, "You shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only." And Satan left him for a time, and angels ministered. Do you see now the pattern by which Nehemiah, a God-fearing Jewish man, lived? The same thing that Jesus lived by: power in prayer and submission to the God of the universe. This is how we live, church. This is what we're supposed to do. See, here's something that we do when we come to Christ, and all of us have been guilty, and I'm admitting to you my guilt today. Some of us come to Christ thinking it'll make our lives easier. Or, and this is the one I've been guilty of, I want to submit all the bad things to God to keep all the good things to myself. But God is an all or nothing God. You cannot have one foot in the world and one foot in the Word. There is but one way, because here's the thing. God's word is a ship that's leaving this shore. If you have one foot on the dock and one foot on the boat, and the boat is rapidly leaving, eventually you're going to have to choose a side, or you're going to end up wet with painful splits. You have to choose who you're going to serve. Y'all might recall when we talked through Joshua. Joshua brought all the people together, and he said these words: "Our ancestors beyond the Jordan River worshiped many gods. And when we were in Egypt, they worshiped many gods. But you have to choose this day whom you're going to serve. Are you going to serve the gods our ancestors worshiped, or the gods that the Egyptians worshiped, or the gods of the people who we just displaced from this land? You have to choose. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." This does not merely mean coming to church on Sunday morning. It doesn't mean merely doing good things. Just as Tristan, the theologian, had told us, just as Jacob and Finn had told us, it's being thankful. It means that every breath, every thought, every action, our rising up and our laying down until the final time we close our eyes is submitted wholly unto the Lord. It doesn't mean that we look around and complain and yell and shout. It means that when we realize that it's getting darker outside the walls of the church, it's time for the light to shine. And I know many of us are distressed at the world today. We look around and we get upset, but guess what? Whenever there's an upheaval, there's always riots. You look at the book of Acts, everywhere Paul went, there seemed to be a riot. That means that God has placed you, church, in this time, in this place, in this climate, for His glory and purposes. But how, church, then do we face it? Fasting and weeping and prayer and absolute submission to God. That's the only way. Paul admitted to the Corinthians in his second letter that there was more than he could bear. And I wish that slogan that we like to say would go away and die. Because God does give us more than we can bear. But He never gives us more than He can bear. And by prayer and by fasting and by submitting to God, Nehemiah was able to face down even death. But it's not always rosy when God does answer our requests. Let's take a look at what goes on next. I said to the king, verse 7, if it pleases the king, let letters be given to the governors of the provinces beyond the river, that they may let me pass through until I come to Judah. And a letter to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the fortress of the temple, and the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall occupy. And the king granted me what I asked. For the good hand of my God was upon me. Nehemiah did not give himself credit, but it was all done by the hand of God. So Nehemiah came, verse 9. Then I came to the governors of the province beyond the river, and I gave them the king's letters. And now the king sent me with officers of the army and horsemen. See, the king gave him even beyond the blessing that was promised. The king gave him not merely guards, but the officers of his own army. That is the power of our God. That when we ask and the Lord answers, He asks and He answers and He delivers beyond anything we could have hoped for or imagined. That's the greatness of our God. You put your hope in God, He will not fail. We might. We might even fall and give our lives. But He will be glorified and honored, and His purposes will shine through. Now here's the problem. But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite servant heard this, it displeased them greatly that someone had come to seek the welfare of the people of Israel. You see, this is also an effect of prayer and fasting. We will face opposition. Jesus fasted for 40 days and the devil himself showed up. Why do we think we'll be any different? Why? Because the enemy's purpose is to kill and to steal and destroy. And he does not want God having victory over your life. Why? Because he is a creature in rebellion. He is the beginner of the rebellion. And those in rebellion do not like to see those who are upright actually succeed. And so what's he going to do? He will send opposition. Because a life submitted to God completely proves the power of God Almighty. And those in rebellion cannot understand it. You see, Nehemiah had all the right credentials, didn't he? Nehemiah had letters from the king. And yet, he still received oppositions from those within the kingdom. Verse 11 says, so I went to Jerusalem and was there 3 days. Then I arose in the night, and I and a few men with me, and I told no one what my God had put into my heart to do for Jerusalem. There was no animal with me but the one on which I rode. I went out by night by the valley gate to the dragon spring and to the dung gate, and I inspected the walls of Jerusalem that were broken down and its gates that had been destroyed by fire. And I went to the fountain gate into the king's pool, but there was no room for the animal that was under me to pass. Then I went up in the night by the valley and inspected the wall, and I turned back, and I entered the valley gate and so returned. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, and I had not yet told the Jews, the priests, the nobles, the officials, and the rest who were to do the work. Why did Nehemiah do this? And how does this apply to our walk? Well, the answer comes from Jesus in the book of Luke. He said, if you're to follow me, first consider the cost. If you're to do the work the Lord puts before you, you have to consider what it costs. And I'm going to tell you something. Following the Lord costs you nothing short of everything. We've had to leave family behind because the Lord called us to do it. We've had to leave friends that we've loved dearly still to this day. We've had to leave it all behind. Why? Because God's mission is more important than my feelings. God's purposes are greater than the plans that I have. And so if I'm going to follow Jesus, I need to first consider what the cost will be. He says, which one of you wants to build a tower, but when he finds out he doesn't have enough money, will have it only half finished? Or if an enemy army is coming, which one of you, if you only have 10,000 soldiers and he 50, you're not going to go out and make peace with them before he arrives? One man said to Jesus, Lord, I'll follow you anywhere. But what did Jesus say? Foxes have holes, and the birds of the air, beards of the air would be weird. The birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. And still another approached him. Lord, I'll follow you anywhere, but first let me bury my father. A reasonable request, right? But how did Jesus reply? Let the dead bury themselves. You follow me. What was the man asking? Was he asking for a funeral? Absolutely not. He was saying, let me make the preparations for my dad. This could take quite a while, Lord. That's really what he's saying. Because back in those days, a funeral was quite the event. You had to prepare. You had to prepare for the burial. So you had to lay aside a tomb. You had to go and make the preparations for how the inheritance would get divided up. You had to go and do all those things. But Jesus said, let the dead bury themselves. If he's calling you, he's calling you now, not then. Still another said, Lord, let me follow you, but first let me say goodbye to my friends. And Jesus said these words, and these words sting and they hurt. But understand that he has the best intentions for you in mind by them. He who puts his shoulder to the plow and looks back is not worthy of me. Why does he say it? Because when you start the work of the Lord, you need to finish the job he gives you. And I've never been a farmer. As a matter of fact, I think I've got like probably a brown thumb. I managed to grow potatoes, but that was easy. But if you start the work in growing and planting, and you keep stopping, you're not going to be done in time for the harvest. That's an unworthy farmer. And Jesus says, if you're coming after me, come with me. If not, go. You have to choose. The ship is leaving the dock. Are you going to board the boat or not? And Nehemiah, in the same way, had to make sure he was completely on board. He needed to see the resources he needed. Because if he was going to do it, he was going to do it all the way. Not merely repair the gates, not merely repair the wall, repair the wall around the temple. Do it right. Complete the job and get it done. This was his resolve. And in verse 17, he says to the officials, then I said to them, you see the trouble we are in now, how Jerusalem lies in ruins with its gates burned. Come, let us build the wall of Jerusalem that we no longer suffer derision. And I told him that the hand of my God that had been upon me for good, and also the words of the king that he had spoken to me. And they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for the good work. You see what happens when we also pray? We strengthen others for the work. This is the role of the elders and the preacher of the church. We are here to strengthen the hands. You are the body just as we are. The work is just as much yours as it is ours. And I pray for you. And I weep over you. And I fast over you. I'm not saying this to boast in me, but merely the hand of my God is great. And by looking at your faces here this morning, I know His favor is here. So as we labor, as we assess, as we rise to do the work, my prayer is that through the preaching of His word, you are also empowered and your hands are strengthened also for the work that needs to be done. And we're seeing it. Praise the Lord, we're seeing it. We're seeing people come to the Lord in spite of restriction. We're seeing people saved and giving their lives and identifying with Christ through baptism over and over and over again. And this isn't the work of Brian Doyle. This is the work that God has put on your hearts. I haven't had a single conversation that didn't start with one of y'all first. Let your hands be strengthened. Because God is a mighty God. God can and will succeed. And what He starts, no man can stop. Yet the opposition comes again. Listen to this. When we choose to do the Lord's work, it's going to happen. I'm telling you this because when you strengthen your hand to do the Lord's work, the enemy will not take it lying down. Verse 19 says, "But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite servant and Geshem the Arab heard of it, they jeered at us and despised us, saying, 'Are you rebelling against the king?' Even though they knew it wasn't true." It's the oldest trick in the book. Consider the serpent in the garden. What was the very first thing he got Eve to deny? Did God really say that? And it's what Satan is going to continue to whisper in your ears the moment you step up to do the work the Lord has before you. Did God really say that? Haven't you done enough? You've done some good work. Just stop and relax. Are you sure this is what God would want? I bet if I was to take a poll of this room, every single one of us had heard that at least three times this week. Strengthen your hand. The hand of God is upon you. The walls can and will be rebuilt. And God will come and make all things new and right. You just have to remain faithful to the work He puts before you. Verse 20. And I love how Nehemiah responds. "Then I replied to them, 'The God of heaven will make us prosper, and we, His servants, will arise and build, but you have no portion or right or claim in Jerusalem.'" When Satan comes up, we can do exactly as Jesus did. "Go away from me, Satan." And as the book of James promises, if you resist the devil, he will flee from you. There is no power on heaven and earth that is greater than the King of Kings, Jesus Christ. His is the name by which every tongue will confess. And every knee will bow down one way or the other. And if you are bowing down now to do the work that the Lord your God has put before you, there is nothing that can stop the work. There is nothing that can stop the work. It doesn't matter what's going on in Washington. It doesn't matter what's going on at the State House. It doesn't matter what's going on in the UN. It doesn't matter what's going on in the world today. The Lord, our God, has a plan put into motion, and the hands of man and the hands of Satan cannot stop it. Amen. On that beach when he denied himself, Peter was told, "I call you Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail." From the mouth of Christ, it will not come back void. The creator and designer of the universe, the one who knit you together in your mother's womb, if he said it, it will happen. Have faith and move forward regardless of the opposition. Jesus told these words to his disciples. Matthew 28, verse 16, they went to the place he told them, but some of them doubted. And so how did Jesus begin his great commission of them? "All authority on heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." And here is the kicker here, church. This is what we stand upon. This is what we can believe. "Behold, I am with you always, even to the very end, end of the day, the end of the decade, the end of your life, the end of the age. And if he is always with you, no matter what you face, you are strong. What did Paul write? For I am convinced that neither life nor death, nor angels, nor demons, nor powers or principalities, anything, nothing can separate us from the love of God. So church, pick up your head. Strengthen your hands. Fast, weep, and pray, and go to work. There is a dark world out there that needs light. And you are commissioned by Christ to be that light. And the light shines brightest when the world gets darkest. So go out and be that light. I'm going to invite the elders to come forward. We're going to sing one more song. But I've also got some brothers and sisters in Christ who are willing. If you need prayer today, these brothers and sisters in Christ are going to be standing on the sides. You don't have to come forward. I know it's daunting to come all the way to the front of the church with everybody watching you. Let there be no excuse to come to God today. If you are struggling, if you are hurting, if you are going through something, be like Nehemiah and pray. Get prayer. Hear the voice of God and trust the hand is upon you. Maybe today you've never given your life to Christ. I got some good news for you. Jesus came down to take care of our sin. He nailed it to the cross along with himself. He was buried. He rose again on the third day, and thus the sin problem that caused death was fully destroyed. There is no victory in sin and death. It has no stain. And we can get in on that this morning. Amen. Christ rose, and he is coming back someday. I want to be ready for him. I'm going to strengthen my hands, and I hope you do too. Let's stand and worship.
Oh, sin, come me. Earth has no sorrow.
this young man
confess before the whole church. I'm telling you, it's difficult to stand up and speak. I don't eat breakfast on Sunday mornings because I still find it difficult. The last week, this young man confessed with his mouth that Jesus Christ is his Lord. Yeah. 2 weeks ago. And now that his family can be here, we're so grateful to have all your grandparents here and all that. He's putting on Christ through baptism. So what I'd like to do before we go to get ready, the elders are going to come and we're going to pray over Jacob. And then he's going to go get ready. I'm going to go get ready. And we're going to watch a new birth this morning.
Lord Heavenly Father, we just praise you this morning because we know the angels in heaven are celebrating today.
Yes.
We thank you for this young man who decided to give his life to you and live a life pleasing to you. And Lord, we just pray that you'll keep your angel army wrapped around him at all times, surround his body, surround his life, and surround every thought that he has so that he may be making the decision to follow you and follow your guidance throughout his life. We thank you for his parents who raised him in you, and we just pray blessings upon them as well. Again, we lift him up, and we just pray that he will continue to walk in your life throughout the rest of his life. We pray this in Jesus' precious name.
Our Father God, we're so grateful, so joyous, this one who has come this morning. Father, the elder said that the angels are rejoicing. Mm-hmm. Father, we need to rejoice here on earth as well.
Yes, sir.
Father, we pray for this young man as he's made a decision. Father, he has heard the word. Listen to him, Father, as he has obeyed it. Be one of ours. Thank you so much for him. Pray, Father, that you will help us to be encouragers, to lead him, to keep him, train him up in ways. Thank you for all you do.
All right, we got a video we're going to play while we're going to play.
Thank you.
Well, technical difficulties aside, well, how about this? I'll just talk through it. Why not? I can talk.
All right, well, you know, if y'all ever get a chance, we've got what we call kid videos online, and that wasn't one of them, but we can all share the gospel simply. It's not a difficult gospel. We've added and tried to make it our own over the years, but here's a simple part of the gospel. We all have two problems. Sin. And God told us in the Garden of Eden that sin would lead to death. And because we have those two problems, because in our nature we are rebellious, one just has to have an angry three-month-old to see that rebellion. Jesus Christ came down, and he put on human flesh, and he lived a perfect life, obedient completely to God. He, as John the Baptist called him, was the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And so what did they do? They nailed him to the cross. But when they nailed him to the cross, they didn't merely nail him to the cross. They nailed your sin and mine to the cross. They put him in the ground for 3 days. He rose again. He took care of the problem that sin caused, death, by rising again, which promises us that we also shall rise again. He rose to the right hand of the Father. He is sitting there to this day, and someday he's coming back again. Isn't that good news? Did the gospel take that long to share? You don't need to have a theology degree. You can share with someone that Christ took care of sin. And here's how we can get in on that good news. We can go put on Christ through baptism. He gives us the gift of the Holy Spirit. And we are then part of Christ's family. So I want to encourage y'all. Share the gospel this week. We are not promised one more moment than we have now. And there is somebody out there, I guarantee you, needs to hear the good news. I learned this phrase, and if you know the answer, you know, shout it out. When you're at the stone quarry, which stroke of the hammer breaks the rock? What's that?
Every stroke.
Every single stroke breaks the rock. So if someone hears the gospel one time and doesn't hear it, doesn't respond to it, okay. But if it takes 500 times to break a stone at the quarry, and 500 times to tell the gospel until someone's heart is finally ready to receive the news because the Holy Spirit is just that powerful, let's continue to stay. Romans 1:16 says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to those who believe." So if it's the power of God, let's unleash the power everywhere we go. That being said, we're ready? All right. Okay. Is he on that side?
Yes.
Okay. The door locked?
He's just saying that.
Okay. All Jacob, because you have confessed that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, you have said he is your Lord and Savior now in obedience to his will. And for the remission of your sins and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
death to new life.
Life